But then the classroom shortage this year is even higher than that of last year. The DepEd reported that this coming school year, the shortage for classrooms is at 159,000. Last year, it was at 91,000. So there has to be some accountability here. The weather is a given. Climate change is a given. So what is the reason? Is it a lack of funding? Is it absorptive capacity? Is the DepEd utilizing the funds the way they should?
Okay. It's the number one and number two reason, lack of funding. If you look at the pre-pandemic time, because pandemic, we didn't allocate funds for building of classroom for obvious reason. There was no face-to-face classes. But even pre-pandemic time, the allocation for classroom is between 10 billion to a high of 30 billion. Mm-hmm. And if you look at the classroom requirements pre-pandemic time, 5 years prior, the budget required to, just to fulfill all the new classrooms is around 400 billion. And that never changed. Until now, Karen, it's still at around 400 billion. Mm-hmm. So in other words, in short, we need 400 billion just to catch up. This is outside of the repairs, but we allocate only 10 to 30 billion at the most in terms of new classroom building. So that's why I suggested during the hearing that let's think outside the box. If you look at the population growth, learner population growth in the private schools, it's actually going down from pre-pandemic level. It went down by 16%. So in other words, there are excess capacities in our private schools that we can use via the voucher system. So I was recommending to the DepEd, let's look at the excess capacities of our private schools and rechannel our students there. In fact, all of these private schools are actually located in congested areas such as Quezon City, even Valenzuela, and we can rechannel our students using the excess capacities of our private schools.
And Senator, based on your data, are we using the voucher system in a most, at least have we maximized it?
So far, yes. We have allocated close to about 52 billion for the ESC, the education service contracting, and also the voucher system for junior and senior high school. So this is actually the biggest amount government has allocated to the voucher system for students to go to the private schools. But let's run the economics. What's more expensive and more cumbersome, building classroom or issuing vouchers for students to go to private schools? And common sense will dictate, vouchers is easy. You just issue vouchers, you give it to the students and let the students decide where to go. So, but let's run the economics, because because we're also running the economics, maybe it's cheaper to increase the budget of the voucher system, and we hit two birds with one stone. We decongest our public school, and at the same time, we use the excess capacities of the private schools and improve their financial standing.
Mm-mm. Okay, because I've read a story, this is printed by Rappler, and it's an enterprise story, wherein teachers have already started yung Piso GCash Challenge. So ideally, under the 2023 Brigada Escuela implementing guidelines, teachers should not be soliciting funds. And yet, you have teachers openly asking kahit piso lang para sa GCash for the opening of classes to help prepare classrooms, buy student materials. So we've come to this place right now.
Actually, the Brigada Escuela is it's an activity where students, parents, teachers, the community clean and prepare the classrooms. And the donation is voluntary. And in fact, the PTA has been instrumental in terms of raising funds. There's we discussed this during the hearing. There's an outstanding order that schools cannot collect because it might be misconstrued that collection is mandatory. If not, the learners cannot go in or your child cannot go to school. So there's an outstanding memo that it's called the no collection policy. But the PTA has been instrumental in terms of raising voluntary funds to help our schools clean up, beautify them, and prepare them. And I have to give credit to the PTAs because on their own volition, they help out bringing our classrooms to its ready state.
Okay, pero Senator, hindi po ba included sa budget yon kada taon ang repair ng classrooms?
Yeah, kasama naman. No? For high school, there's MOE. For elementary, it's the division gives the budget to clean up classroom. But admittedly, some schools are big. And admittedly, some schools need more repairs. Like for example, if you need to repair your roof or you need waterproofing, sometimes those budgets, those allocations are not in the DepEd budget. Actually, the LGUs, like here in Valenzuela, the LGUs play a very big role in terms of repairing classrooms. So it's really a community effort. Admittedly, that the DepEd budget is not enough for all close to about 50,000 schools nationwide. But the community plays a big role. The LGUs plays a big role in terms of filling the gap.
Okay. Now, other than that, there's a glaring teacher shortage. You have many schools opening with essentially the need for teachers. The COA report says that the DepEd struggled to fill the target teachers' positions. In 2019 to 2021, they plan to hire over 9,000 teachers. They haven't hired. What's the problem there?
Actually, Karen, that's a perennial problem as well, and I plan to raise that during the budget deliberation. Ever since, I've noticed that hiring teachers take time. When you look at the process, normally it takes almost 7 to 8 months to hire one teacher. And the unfilled positions in DepEd is as high as 30,000. So meaning there are 30,000 available positions. I think almost 10 to 15,000 are teachers, teacher one at that. But it takes time to hire people, especially teachers. And apparently, the hiring goes to a lot of different government agencies, the DepEd, the CSC, and other agencies. So we advise DepEd to fix the process because it's really unjustifiable that our classrooms are not staffed with teachers, and there are available positions and available funding for those teachers. And we see that especially in the urban areas like in Quezon City, here in Metro Manila. So we really need to improve the process, and I plan to raise that during the budget hearing on what reforms they've undertaken to improve the process, because this is not the first time.
Okay, and not only that, in the latest COA report, it said that the DepEd actually failed to utilize the funding for the hiring of teachers. They wrote that 1 billion pesos for hiring wasn't used. It remained untouched. And in DepEd Cotabato office, there was 106 million pesos for the hiring of teachers. They didn't spend it too.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a process problem. No, that's a, it's not a funding problem, Karen. And I've seen that during the time of Secretary Briones. In fact, I remember very clearly when I asked this, she said they will reform the process. So it's not a funding problem. It's not a position problem. It's really a process problem. And processes are processes. So you can change those. And I plan to raise that and ask what happened to the reform that DepEd has undertaken during the last administration.
Okay, so this year there are roughly more than 21 million learners, right? Our ranking is, we're not doing quite well. We have 8-year-olds who can't read, 10-year-olds who are not up to par. Senator, where are we going with our public school system?
Correct. I think that is the learning poverty report by the World Bank, wherein almost 90% of our learners, 10-year-old learners, cannot read and cannot understand a simple story. That's a glaring information. In fact, that's a wake-up call for all of us. And we've been pushing to simplify the curriculum. In fact, years before, we've already flagged DepEd through experts as well, that our curriculum is so decongested.
Yeah.
We're teaching so many things to our kids that they're not learning anything. Mm. In fact, there's a survey that was conducted that only 40% of our teachers can finish all the subjects and all the competencies assigned to them. And yet, at the end of that school year, we test our students. No wonder our national achievement test is very low, because you test them 100% of the competencies, but they only learn 40%. So
yeah.
that's a glaring fact that DepEd needs to address. And that is now addressed by the new curriculum. If you look at the new curriculum, they reduce competencies by almost 70%.
Mm-hmm.
And they reduce subjects, especially on key stage one, kinder to grade three, by 2 to 3 subjects. So in other words, the focus is on what they call the foundational skills, reading and numeracy. It's important that our students have those strong foundational skills so that they can move to the next level without any problems.
And what's difficult, for example, is it's a domino effect. It's like
yes.
chicken or the egg situation. In Kalumpit, Bulacan, the story
yeah.
is there's so many classrooms that can't be used because baha. Hanggang ngayon,
yeah.
may tubig. And ang
yeah.
mangyayari, they'll shift. They'll do shifting. Blended learning, kids go home with their modules. And we know that's not as effective.
Yes. Correct. In fact, there's a survey that I saw conducted by World Bank. You're absolutely correct. The modules are not effective, especially from kindergarten all the way to grade 5, grade 6.
Mm.
Because these are learners who need teachers, who need guidance, and they cannot self-learn.
Mm.
You cannot ask 6 years old to self-learn because they need their teachers. No? They need someone to teach them.
Okay.
And actually, another glaring problem that I saw is that our dropout rates from grade 1 all the way to grade 3 is as high as 20%.
Yeah.
And it's actually puzzling for me, because normally you see dropouts at the teenage level, for example, fourth year high school to probably grades 12.
Mm.
But we've seen a high incidence of dropout as early as grades 1, grades 2, all the way to grade 3. And the reason for that is probably also a lot of our students are not confident that they are learning, and they find it very difficult to go to school. Mm. So, and if a child finds it difficult to learn and to go to school, they'll drop out. And that's why the reform in our curriculum is very important, because it will improve the capacity to learn by our learners. And it will also, in my opinion and my analysis, it will also improve or lessen the dropout rates that we are experiencing.
Okay. And speaking of education, just recently, the vice president, who's also secretary, ordered that classrooms in public schools have to be left bare. No visual aids, nothing. So you saw teachers taking out ABCs, the alphabet, number guides in the classroom. Do you agree with this?
My understanding of that, Karen, is because DepEd wants our classrooms to be clean and to be neat and to be presentable. But our teachers are trained to teach, and they will use every method, every pedagogy, every collateral to help
Mm-mm.
learners learn. Now, for example, in kindergarten students learn visually.
Yeah.
And the reason why we put ABCs, the animals, 1, 2, 3s, is because to improve the understanding of our learners with the basics, with alphabets and with numeracy. The same with grade 1s and grade 2 and grade 3. So our teachers should not be prohibited in terms of putting collaterals that will help learning. That should not be the case. But I understand that the direction of that memo is to clean up the classrooms, but not to hamper teaching.
But then we know visual aids, it's been proven to actually
yeah.
help educate a student.
Correct. That's why my understanding is it's not meant to hamper teaching. Teachers can freely put collaterals that will help their teaching that will help our students understand concepts. But at the same time, they have to be mindful that our classrooms need to be clean and need to be neat as well. That's my understanding of that memo, because teachers are trained. They know what our students need, and they should be given the flexibility to use whatever method that they are trained with in order to teach and in order for our students to absorb the lessons that they need to learn.
Okay, so you've just said that teachers know what to do. They're trained. They know what the students need. I believe that you have critics already criticizing the vice president, although her efforts are admirable, saying that what we need in education is an expert in education, right? So I wanted to ask you your thoughts on this.
Yeah, well, Karen, the vice president is a mayor, no? And I've talked to her about many things in the realm of education. I'm not an educator also, I'm not a teacher. But we both come from the local government units. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of concerns that can be addressed by the local government unit. And I'll give you a very specific example that I talked to her about. Early childhood care and development, ECCD. Yeah. And this is, in our design, our daycares are run by the local government units, but the policy comes from national. And if you don't understand how local governments implement ECCD, or there's no interest with the local governments in improving ECCD, it's very difficult to mobilize local governments, and it's difficult to have a successful ECCD program. So the strength of the vice president, she comes from the local government units. She understands how local governments operate, and she can push down education programs to the local government, so the local governments can mobilize them. Another facet that I've seen how the vice president manages the DepEd is she hires experts. Yusek Gina Gonong is an expert in education, and she runs our curriculum and instruction strand, which is a very important department, because that feeds in information and education to the minds of our youth. And it's important that she gets quality people. And from what I see, one of the most important position, which is curriculum, is run by an expert. So you have the best of both worlds. No? You have someone who is someone who is an expert in local government, someone who has actually experienced local government operation, but at the same time, you have also experts in the field of curriculum, in the field of other education facets, and you put them together to come up with a holistic program. So that's how I look at it, Karen.
All right. I remember in September 2022, the vice president said she can fix education in 6 years if given 100 billion pesos. Do you agree with this? I mean, frankly, with looking at the problems we have now.
Well, it's going to take time, Karen, because education, as you know, is a 13-year cycle. You have kindergarten all the way to grade 12.
Yeah.
And I think it's going to be very difficult for a single administration to measure success at that. You can measure success in short term, for example, every key stage, but you have to wait 13 years for that student to graduate in order to measure whether that student actually performed well or not. But I don't really believe in just looking at the short term. Education is a long game, and that's what I've learned from doing this work for many years. It's a long game, and you need to put the fundamentals and foundation in place on day one so that the next administration, or probably the second administration, the second next administration, will feel the gains. We cannot just look at one administration and claim that we're successful. We have to look at the next administration or the two next administration, because it's really a long game. And what's important is looking at the right foundations being placed now, in order for our learners to be successful in the next few years or after their graduation at grade 12.
Okay, but then that particular statement, she had said that if the DepEd got an extra 100 billion, it would actually help solve the country's education problems. And then you have critics saying, but you have the office of the vice president with 500 million, for example, DepEd intelligence funds or CONFI funds at 150. So there seems to be a disconnect, for you have education experts. They're now quite confused where we're headed in terms of priorities.
Well, in terms of spending for education, we're now at close to around 4.7 to our GDP, 4.7% to our GDP. The international standard is about 4 to 6%. So we're actually doing quite well in terms of spending, but at the low end.
But is it spending in terms of the budget? Because what happens is, even if it's in the budget, it isn't spent.
Yes, that's another issue. No, the absorptive capacity. Yeah. You mentioned absorptive capacity, Karen. You're absolutely correct. In fact, that is always the criticism with DepEd in the past.
Yeah.
That they are asking, DepEd's budget is close to about 800 billion. No? Mm. And the problem with a big budget is how to spend it. Mm. And perennially, the problem is they're not hiring as fast, they're not building as fast, they're not spending, for example, for information technology as fast. Mm-mm. So that's always a problem. And there's always it's a chicken and the egg question, because you keep on asking budget, but you cannot spend it. Mm. And then therefore, Congress would not allocate a bigger budget. So just to go back, in terms of spending per GDP, we're doing quite well, but the DepEd needs to improve the capacity to spend, or the absorptive capacity to spend all of those funds. And I personally plan to raise it again during the budget hearing, because that's a point of contention for many, many years. Looking at DepEd's budget.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you so much for joining me this morning, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, Committee Chairman on Basic Education. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen.